You know what that was?
What?
That was a full half hour of the Stan Freberg show played backward at high speed. How would you like to hear it played forward at normal speed?
Please.
This is the 14th show of the series of a brand new radio series.
From Hollywood, we present the Stan Freberg Show, brought to you by Stan Freberg.
With the music of Billy May.
Plus the songs of Peggy Taylor with Dawes Butler, June Foray, Peter Leach, and Judd Conlon, and Rhythm Ayers.
You may not find us on your TV,
because in case you did not know, we're being brought to you on. Brought to you on. Brought to you by RADI.
That's right. Tonight's show is being brought to you by me. And I have retained the services of the World Advertising Agency to help me with the commercials.
Stan?
What is it, Dawes Butler, as they say in radio?
Are you really sponsoring yourself this week?
Certainly.
Yeah, but it's not very modest, Stan. I mean, doing commercials on yourself.
Modest schmodest. I paid $100 for this show.
Yikes.
That's an awful lot of money.
Oh, true, but don't forget, I got you, June, Peggy, Peter, Judd, and six singers, Billy May, and the whole orchestra. It adds up, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we'll get to my commercials in a minute. Meanwhile, I have just completed a very dangerous assignment. Freberg, I said to myself, for indeed that was my name. Why don't you get an interview with the Abominable Snowman? So here, then, is the interview with one of these dreaded ape-like creatures as I recorded it high in the Himalayan mountains. This is Stan Freberg speaking high in the Himalayan mountains in northern India. I'm standing next to this particular creature, what is it you are there?
A little of each, Stan, actually.
A little of each,
that's right.
I see, then you are the abominable...
Snowman, that's right. I never cared for that word abominable too much, Stan. You mind if I call you Stan?
No, not at all.
Well, I never cared for abominable, but it's the nearest word translated from the original Hindustani, which was abominuyamayo. Which means the hairy one with the big feet.
Yeah, I can see it lost something in the translation. I was noticing your...
Noticing my sneakers there, were you?
Quite large, yeah. What are they, about 12?
What, are you kidding? 12? They're size 23.
That's pretty big.
Well, it's functional design, you know. Did you ever try to walk on snow with ballet slippers? Or roller skates?
Well, yeah, don't you have a little bit of trouble buying them? I mean...
Well, I just can't walk into any old store and buy them. No, I have them specially made up for me.
Well, where do you get them?
Well, when I don't have the chance to drop by Abercrombie and Fitch, I send up to Spalding. They make them up for me. I have them in four colors, the white, the red, the pink, and the orange. I'm wearing the orange today.
Oh, that's very nice.
Well, that's the particular ensemble I picked out today.
Oh, it's not much of an ensemble, is it? I mean, it's just the shoes.
Well, it's an ensemble to me. Some of us aren't too well off as others.
Well, I didn't mean to hurt your feelings.
Oh, that's all right.
It's all right?
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
All right. Fine.
Just, what is it you do for a living? You terrorize the mountain?
That's right. I terrorize the mountain climbers who come up here. That is my trade, and I am proud of it.
Is it hard work? You have to do a lot of training?
Well, I don't think everybody can do it, you know. They don't have the hair for it, for one thing.
Or the sneakers. Say, you're quite tall, you know. What are you, about 8, 9 feet?
No, I measure in around 10 and a half, buddy.
10 and a half feet tall? Gee, that's pretty tall.
You think I'm tall? You should see my brother. He'd jump center for Abominable State.
Oh, I'm sorry, I missed him. Have you had a pretty good day's work today?
No, it hasn't been too hard today so far, no. Mm-mm.
You, what was that again?
Mm-mm.
You done much terrorizing?
No, not too much today.
Well, I wonder if you could give us a demonstration before we sign off of whatever it is you do,
To terrorize the mountain climber? Certainly.
Well, what would you like me to do?
Well, just turn your back there and close your eyes. Close your little eyes, and I sort of sneak up behind you and let fly with one.
Let fly with one what?
Never you mind, just turn your back.
Well, I think I ever...
Never mind, just turn your back, please. No peeking.
All right.
Don't you open those eyes now.
I won't.
All right. I'll just sneak up behind you now, tippy-toe. Which is hard with my feet. Here I come now.
Yikes!
Gave you a little start there, didn't I, Stanley? Say, that white hair is very becoming. Sets off your ruddy complexion. Very nice.
Gee, that was effective. Well, guys, I see our time is up.
Oh, that's a shame. Sure you don't have time for a quickie before you hit the pike?
No, I really don't.
Well, if you'll forgive me, I gotta get back to work. I see a mountain climber over there by the edge.
Well, nice meeting you.
Nice meeting you, Stan.
Nice to see a man happy in his work. Oh, thank you. Well, I guess I better get over to World Advertising and see if they got some commercials for me.
Good morning, and welcome to World Advertising.
Why, yes, good morning, Miss...
Teasley.
I'd like to see Mr...
Gambit.
Mr. Gambit.
He'll see you right now, right this way.
Oh, fine, all right. Thank you very much.
Mr. Barger, Mr. Freeberg, to see Mr. Gambit.
Yes, sir.
Pleased to see you, Mr. Freeberg.
Yes, here, I'm pleased to see you.
Miss Fodner, Mr. Freeberg for Mr. Gambit.
Pleasure to see you.
Nice to meet you.
Down this way.
All right.
Yes, Miss Fodner.
Mr. Freeberg, to see Mr. Gambit, you be.
Oh, pleasure.
How do you do?
Over here, please.
All right.
JT, Mr. SF to CFG.
Okay.
Pleasure to make it.
Up here, please.
Yes, well, I...
Through there.
Yes?
Stan Freeberg.
Oh, come right in. Stan, my boy. Wait, stand right there. Don't move. I can see it now. The camera dollies in closer and closer. We focus on one eye and superimpose Stan, the man, Freeberg. What a picture.
But, Mr. Gambit, will that be good on radio?
I like a man with perspective, Stan. I can tell your shirt collar buttons in the back. You're one of us. Now,
yes.
Why is it you've come to us again?
Well, this week I'm sponsoring myself. I thought I'd like you to handle the commercials.
Oh, yes.
Have you ever handled a product like Freeberg before?
Oh, yes, indeed. We've handled dog products before.
Yeah, but have you ever handled a human being before?
My boy, we've handled countries before. We're called World Advertising because we're equipped to handle countries.
Gee, I never heard of a nation having an advertising agency before.
My boy, we represent West Germany, Switzerland, Thailand, and Disneyland.
Great nations all.
Now, let me show you a little sample campaign we did for the good old USA.
America is mild.
Yes, for people who know countries best, it's America 2-1. Here's a man with red and white striped pants, blue coat, a top hat with stars around it, and a white goatee. Have you ever seen me before, sir?
No, I haven't.
All right. Here's a little soil from another country. Take it in your hand.
All right.
Now, drill for oil in it. Plant cotton in it. Establish great industry in it for the little man as well as the big. Move the Dodgers in it.
Sorry, I can't do it. Nothing is happening.
All right. Now, take a little bit of this American earth in your other hand.
All right. Say, look at that. Oil is being drilled. Look at that cotton growing. Look at that great industry being established for the little man as well as the big. And look at those Dodgers being moved.
California, here we come. Gonna be an L.A. thumb.
Well, Unc, how about it? You've tried both native soils now. What do you think?
Well, the American soil, it's milder. Definitely milder.
Yes, and you too will say... I'm sold on America.
Some campaign, eh, boy?
Yeah, gee, that was nifty. Is that the kind of commercial you're going to do for me? I mean, you're going to drill for oil in me?
You see, we've got to give you the human touch. I see you earthy, simple, as American as an apple pie, a hot dog, a briar patch leg. First thing we've got to do is to make you more pathetic. Here.
What are you doing there?
Yeah, I'm tearing the buttons off your coat to get you more sympathy.
Yeah, but...
Now, you're a bachelor. Women will want to mother you. You have a hole in your shoe?
That I've got.
Oh, good. Excellent. You'll be a cinch to win.
Have you talked to Stevenson lately?
Yes. Now you've got the human touch.
The human touch?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but what about the commercials? Now, the one you sent me over this morning, I didn't care for that too much.
Oh, well, don't worry about it. Now, listen to this one. It's got the human touch. Listen.
Sandy Freeberg, buy some of him today. This show is costing $100, and brother, that is pay. He'll make you chuckle when he appears.
He goofies the jokes on the way to your ears.
Stanley Freeberg.
Doo-ba-doo-ba-doo.
Gee, that's pretty.
The All-American Dog.
All-American Dog, eh?
You'll get a lot to like in a Freeberg. Sneakers, glasses, flip-top head.
That's not exactly what I had in mind.
Sam Freeberg,
boom, boom.
The foaming comedian,
boom, 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 boom.
Floats the jokes right down the drain.
Boom, 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 boom.
Well, through the magic of radio, here I am back in the studio.
High five. Just what does it all mean? We are fortunate to have with us the eminent electronics engineer and scientist, Dr. Herman Horn, who will demonstrate for us the meaning of the word high five. Last week we had such wonderful hi-fi demonstrations as the mating call of the aardvark, Luella Parsons putting catsup on a clam sandwich at the Brown Derby. Goodness knows what fascinating experience is in store for us tonight.
And here he is, that man about electrons, Dr. Herman Horn.
Yes, thank you. By way of simple explanation to the layman, which is a polite way of saying cloth head, hi-fi brings out everything that is on the record. Little subtle things like piano overtones, harp vibrations, clicks, scratches, surface noise. All the things you couldn't hear before and amplifies them with magnificent clarity. Yes. Hi-fi, of course, stands for high fidelity, and no home can be without it. In spite of what your wife says, ignore it. Ignore it. All women are troublemakers who would like to take the money their husbands need desperately for a new and better speaker and selfishly squander it on things like shoes for the children, homogenized milk, or perhaps a second dress. They can sit there and watch their husbands suffer with old equipment which has been obsolete for at least a week and deny him the new theater playback system he needs so badly. Shameful, shameful, Mrs. America. Comes now the contest. If you could guess the sounds we are going to play, you win a life-size, full-color, inflatable latex rubber Liberace. He comes in a sitting position with arms extended, ready to be blown up and set down at your very own piano. Okay, Strudelmeier, blow him up. Gee, that's realistic. Well, certainly looks like Lee. Well, on with the contest. Here is an ordinary sound that you hear around the house every day. What is it? Give up? That was Benny Goodman in a skin diver suit, 20 feet underwater, playing Danny Boy in a kelp bed. Too bad you missed. Well, try again. What is this? Well, you get it? That was King Farouk in a skin diver suit, 20 feet underwater, applauding Benny Goodman. Comes now the last sound. Could you guess it? That was the sound of John L. Lewis giving his eyebrows a crew cut for the summer. Better luck next time. What a shame. Nobody won. All right, Strudelmeier, let the air out of the latex piano player. All right. Now, just a word about the care of hi-fi records. You've heard the expression, cleanliness is next to high fidelity? Well, all right. When you get home from the record store, wash the hands with surgical soap before removing the record from the plastic envelope. Rubber gloves and face mask are optional. Next, approach the machine on tippy-toe. You shouldn't raise no dust. To show you how good a sterile record sounds, my assistant, Strudelmeier, is going to play a dust-free, surgically clean LP that has never been touched by human hands. After he gets through with it, it still ain't been touched by human hands. From the edges, handle it only, Strud. Strudelmeier. It works better if you remove the plastic envelope first. That's a little better. That'll be enough, Strudelmeier. Well, you did it that time, Strudelmeier. As you know, ladies and gentlemen, under the Hi-Fi Oath, Section 22, Paragraph 18, Strudelmeier must be destroyed at once. Get a big fire going under that oil, Strudelmeier. I want it boiling!
Unfortunately, we will not be able to continue with Dr. Horn's speech due to the fact that he seems to be cooking something on the stove. But he will be back again next week with more fascinating information on the subject of hi-fi.
From time to time on this program, we should like to present literary giants of our time. The next voice you will hear will be that of Stan Freberg, coming to you from the office of Albert T. Wand.
Good evening, Mr. Wand.
Good evening, Stan.
Well, Mr. Wong, how's it feel to be our first literary giant?
Well, Stan, I'm not exactly a giant. I mean, I'm only 5'2".
No. See, giant is just an expression. I mean, you're a big man in the field of literature.
Oh, yes.
I didn't mean that you were literally actually a giant.
Yes.
Just,
yes.
You know.
Oh, yes.
Paraphrasing, as it were. Let's get down to cases here and let the folks in on what sort of thing. You understand, all right?
Oh, yes.
Good.
Oh, yes.
And let the folks in on what sort of things you write.
Well, Stan, I write the sayings on the little slips of paper you find inside Chinese fortune cookies.
And allow me to add that they have been some of the most memorable fortune cookies I've ever read. Just wonderful. Would you rattle off a few of the old favorites there, Albert? May I call you Albert?
Oh, I should be most offended if you did not. Well, you folks may remember this one. I wrote it back in 1938, and the whole country went around saying, "Pleasant prospects for the future are indicated."
Wonderful.
And then, thank you. And then I wrote, "Do not act upon the impulse of the moment."
Oh, yes, I remember that so well.
And I'm sure you will all remember this fortune cookie message. It was the first one I ever had published and printed inside a cookie. "A letter of great importance may reach you any day now."
Hold on. Wonderful memories. I remember breaking open a cookie and reading that several years ago, Albert.
And did a letter of great importance reach you?
Yes, I was drafted. I suppose there are other fortune cookie writers.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. But in all modesty, I would like to quote a critic who writes for the Fuyang Tribune. He said, "Wong is the Oscar Hammerstein III of fortune cookies." People all over America walk out of Chinese restaurants humming his messages.
They do indeed. Have you a few words of encouragement, perhaps for young aspiring fortune cookie writers who may be listening tonight?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Each year...
Oh, yes?
Oh, yes. Each year, countless young hopefuls break their hearts trying to crack the inner golden circle of message writers. You've heard the saying, "There's a broken heart for every fortune cookie writer on Maja Long Street."
No, I don't believe I've heard that one.
I wrote it.
And your word of encouragement is?
Keep writing. If you have to start out writing fortunes for weight machines, do it. I got my start writing, "You weigh 198 pounds and will travel." As I like to say, oy vey. So, my advice, stay with it. Don't be discouraged. Every cloud has a silver lining. Say, Stan, that would make a good
message.
Make
a good message, yeah.
I just made that up out of my head, you know.
Real Edgar Guest.
Let me just jot that down here.
Well, while you're jotting it down there, Albert, I'll just stroll out into your factory here. Mr. Wong, you coming with me?
Oh, yes.
Could you explain how the message is put inside the cookie?
Certainly, Stan. After I write the message and it is printed, these girls here lay it on the unfinished cookie, which at this point is flat, like a little pancake. And then almost instantly, the machine folds the cookie and bends it around the message.
Wonderful. I noticed you use girls with long, thin fingers.
Oh, yes. Reason. They have to snatch their hand out of the way fast.
Good reason. Well, what if they don't?
We have to call in a locksmith to get the cookie off their finger. We never lost the cookie yet.
Well, before we sign off, there's something I've been dying to ask you, Mr.
Yes?
Wong.
Oh, yes.
You know the joke that's been making the rounds?
Oh, yes. You are referring to the joke where somebody supposedly opens a fortune cookie and found the message, "Help me, I am being held captive in a Chinese fortune cookie factory."
That's the one, yes.
Well, to tell the truth, Stan, I am just a little bit sick of that one. Mm. Everywhere I go, people pull it on me. I wish I had a dollar for every time I've heard that.
You're a wealthy man, yeah? Well, it's only a joke.
Yes, a poor joke. A poor joke at that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, say, what is that sort of a pounding noise there?
Oh, it's nothing. It's just someone working on the building, Stan. I don't know. It's a workman or something.
Uh-huh. Let's
get back to my office, Stan, please.
All right. And thanks so much for being with us, Mr. Albert T. Wong.
Help! Help! Help!
Well, here now is my favorite arranger, Billy May, with the Judd Conlon Rhythm Airs and a rather unusual version of Cocktails for Two. Billy? Well, where's the rest of it, Billy? That was only the verse. That was only the verse of the song.
Well, everybody knows the chorus of this turkey.
Come on, will you please play the chorus?
No, man.
Look, I'm not knocking the way you played the verse, you understand, but aren't you really going to play the chorus for us?
No, man.
Just worse than waiting for the other shoe to drop.
Now for the lecture by Dr. Herman Hahn on the subject of hi-fi, which, as you know, is the reproduction of music and sound in high fidelity with a full range of frequencies.
They know that, you lunkhead.
Yes.
Now, the first thing...
Pardon me, Doctor.
Well...
I've been kicking around the idea of a little custom installation myself.
There is no such thing as a little custom installation.
Well, now, I only meant that I...
Quiet! Quiet! Here's the equipment you must have. Must. 4 2,000-watt amplifiers and 10 separate preamps, a 21-joule turntable, a diamond stylus, a pearl mesta, and a cotton pickering arm.
What about the speaker?
The whole house becomes a speaker. You move into the garage.
I think we better forget it.
The entire house becomes a giant speaker. Now it's settled.
No, it's not so. Besides, my wife doesn't like loud music.
Loud?
Yes.
I would expect that from a wife. We've got a special demonstration for people like your wife to prove that hi-fi can be soft. Soft and misty as the teardrops in a mother's eyes, as toward the chair her wayward son is slowly led. Nick Kenny, Mirror Syndicate, 1945. The old ones are the best.
Yes.
Okay, Strudelmeier, roll in the crate, gently. Gently now. There we are.
Oh, pardon me. Is that fur on those wheels?
Naturally. There's nothing softer than a mink wheel. If I'd like to hear about it. All right, unpack, Strudelmeier. Inside the crate, in a nest of flogged peach fuzz and eiderup, that's twice as soft as eiderdown. Rests a 2,000-year-old Ming Dynasty porcelain temple bell. Traditionally, it is struck with the soft, fuzzy cottontail of a Ming rabbit. Only hi-fi could ring the delicate highs of this sound. Okay, Strud, let's hear it. Now! Meathead. I said just with the tail, not with the whole lousy rabbit. Shape up, Strudelmeier. You could be replaced by Quasimodo. Which reminds me, before we come to the end of my lecture, I'll show you the difference between highs and lows. You have just heard the high vibrations when our friend here smashed the temple bell, for which he will be fed to the octopi at Marineland right after the show. Now for the low vibrations. Listen as Clumsy here plays a mating call on the Canadian moose horn. Go, Strud. Excellent. Excellent. He has good jazz ideas.
Yes, but his lip isn't too good.
He sat in with Chet Baker the other night, and I think that, what is that? Strudelmeier, is that your moose? Well, get him out of here and stop blushing.
Why don't we just forget about me buying a hi-fi?
Be quiet. Be quiet. As you and your wife sit of an evening, shivering in the garage, listening to your house, these are the wonderful types of sounds you can play on your hi-fi. The sound, for example, of James Cagney removing his makeup. If we had time, he could remove the other 999 faces.
Hey, but what about music? Can I listen to music on my system?
What for? It's only good for checking to see if you have wow and flutter. Or if you can still hear the turntable rumble.
Oh, I
That's
see.
That's all it's for, nothing else.
Yes, I understand.
Perfect. Only purpose.
Mm-hmm.
However, if you persist, let me show you how loud music can be on a real hi-fi system.
Well, that won't be necessary.
Yes, it will. First, I play an average record played through a cheap $5,000 home hi-fi system. See if you don't see how thin the orchestra sounds. Terrible. Now, the very same record played through my own stereophantic, orthopedic, cinema-guadalama-phonic sound system. Okay, Strudelmeier?
Doctor, I really don't think the building can withstand the vibrations.
Stand back, Brady Cat. Now, if you aren't chicken, turn up your volume knobs all the way! We'll be right back.
Tonight only, this special demonstrator studio, only $9.98. Well, in recent months, a brave new type of motion picture has been sweeping the country's screens. A hybrid of the horror picture and the epic of adolescence. Such memorable titles as I Was a Teenage Werewolf have proved a real shot in the exhibitor's arm. However, just as Newsweek announced that shock around the clock was catching on, Daily Variety reports that movie theaters again have a pain in the box office. May we suggest as a remedy, a new kind of story, a sort of cinema composite.
Century Freebird presents Gray Flannel Hat Full of Teenage Werewolves.
Yes, I look like a normal werewolf. Happy, respectable, pointy-toothed, accepted by the werewolf community. But little do they know of that nameless terror with which I live. That unspeakable thing that turns me, when the sun is full, into an advertising man! How did it start? I do not know. I only remember that one night, I returned to my home under a certain bridge in Westchester County, New York. I had spent a normal night werewolfing around Scarsdale and was just getting in when my father woke up.
Hey, is that you, Lobo?
Yes, Pop.
What do you mean, getting in at this hour? It's only 4:30 a.m. A good, decent werewolf is supposed to be out till at least 5:30.
Yeah, but I get tired of running around showing my fangs and biting people. Give me a curfew, Pop. Make me get in by 4:30.
Listen, don't you never want to amount to nothing? This is America, where any kid can grow up to be Dracula.
Yeah, but I don't want to be a werewolf for a living.
Son, now go to sleep before I give you the back of my claw again. Karloff knows what'll happen to you now.
But I didn't go to sleep. I lay there thinking. How long, I do not know. Suddenly, as the sun began to come up, I felt as though a strange transfiguration were taking place. My fangs became short and blunt. My head became crew cut. The hair on my body slowly turned into gray flannel. My head filled with senseless metaphor. And suddenly I knew that I was turning into an advertising man!
Well, let's roll it all up into one big ball of wax, gentlemen. Miss Hotchkiss, get me the presentation on the Emerson account.
Wake up! Wake up, Paul! Lobo's out of his head.
What? Oh,
ball of
He's
wax.
Saying weird things in his sleep.
Ball of wax?
He's running toward the tracks.
Where's he going?
Don't worry, Nanma. He's probably just gone back out to bite a couple commuters.
Yeah. That's a good boy, Lobo!
I ran out from under the bridge, not quite knowing what to do next. I saw a train approaching, bound for New York. As it came abreast of me, I leapt onto it through the open door.
Come on, Johnson. Let's walk on back to the club car and get some coffee.
Oh, check.
What?
Oh, look, there's a guy sort of crouching in the vestibule.
Yeah. What are you doing down on all fours, old man?
Well, let's roll it all up into one big ball of wax, gentlemen.
How's that?
Look here, Johnson's my name. Are you from Scarsdale? I don't believe I saw you at the station.
Why,
Fogarty's my name. You mind if I ask what business you're in?
Miss Hotchkiss, bring me the Emerson account.
Ah, work for an advertising agency, huh? It's a small world, so do we.
Well, let's send up the flag and see if anybody salutes.
Hey, he must work for our agency. Funny, though. Never seen him around the office.
Yeah. Hey, fellas, are we going to stand in this vestibule all day? Let's get some coffee, gentlemen.
I went on in with Johnson and Fogarty to their agency on Madison Avenue. A place called Batten, Barton, Rubicam, and Thompson. Naturally, I started out as a copywriter and worked my way up. I learned new things to say, like, I'm just thinking off the top of my head, boys. Let's mother hen the idea. And I like it, but... With my gray flannel suit, I worked my way up the ladder until I was vice president. I had taken the name of Breisacker, and no one suspected me. I continued being werewolf by night, ad man by day, because when the sun came up, I could not control this gray flannel thing that came over me. And then, of course, there was the business of Miss Wilway.
Would you come in a moment, Miss Wilway, and bring me the food folder?
Yes, Mr. Breisacker.
Yes, now, Fogarty, I hope you don't feel badly because I've been made vice president and you haven't.
Oh, no, 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 that's the way the cookie crumbles, Breisacker. My day is coming.
What do you mean by that, Fogarty?
Nothing.
Here's the presentation on the food account, Mr. Breisacker.
The food account, yeah. Yes, thank you, Miss Wilway. By the by, Miss Wilway, How's about lunch with me today?
Gee, Mr. Breisacker, I'd love it. But wouldn't you rather make it for dinner?
Why, no, I, that is...
Yeah, why not for dinner? Where do you go at night, anyhow? None of us ever see you after you get off at the bridge outside Scarsdale.
What's wrong with that? What are you implying? You think it's unusual that I got off at the bridge?
No. No, I think it's unusual, only because the train doesn't even slow down at the bridge.
Yes, well, shall we say lunch then, Miss Wilway?
I'd love it.
Now, you watch out for him, Lucretia. I hear he's a regular wolf.
What do you mean by that?
Well, look, there's no need to snap at me, Breisacker. Gee, look at his eyes blaze.
Oh, Mr. Breisacker, you're so cute when you're mad.
Yeah, well, don't just stand there. Wipe off his chin.
All right, come on, Fogarty. They're waiting for us and they're in a meeting. I'll expect you to back me up.
Sure. Right against the wall.
Ah, gentlemen.
Good morning, J.B.
Morning, G.G., H.L., P.Q., B.B., D.O.
Well, now let's hear your suggestions on the food account, Breisacker.
Yes. Well, I mother hen this idea for some time, and I think it's about ready to hatch.
Well, let's run up the flag and see if anybody salutes, huh?
You'll give me a chance, Fogarty. I'll get on with my presentation. Yes. Here are the new food radio commercials, gentlemen, hot off the press. Put it on the machine there, Fogarty.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you scratched my commercial!
Now, easy there, Breisacker. There's no need to bite Fogarty's head off.
I'd like that.
Yes, but we're all playing on the same side of the net. If we just rally together, perhaps we can ace one over. Play the record, Fogarty, and we'll see how the ball bounces. Any time is the time for food, 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 food. Just put it in your mouth. Chew it up with your teeth and swallow it.
You can bet your bottom dollar you'll say, food is good. Here's a man right here. Pardon me, sir. I understand you've eaten food.
Yeah, I have.
Would you describe the sensation for us?
Yeah, well, before I ate it, my stomach was growling something fierce. And I had a kind of pain in it.
And what would you call the pain?
Well, sort of hunger.
Yes, hunger. A copyrighted name for Food Incorporated. And what happened to the pain after you ate some food?
It went away.
Yes, leading specialists agree that food is the number one cure for hunger.
Put food in your tummy, tum, 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 tummy, tum, 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 tummy, tum, tum. If you haven't any teeth, ba-ba-ba-ba beanie, you can gum it with your gummy gum gum. You can gum it with your gummy gum gum.
Is that it, Breisacker?
Yes, it is, G.H. What do you think of it?
Well, I like it, but it doesn't have enough, it hasn't got enough, yeah.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more, G.H. No, sir. I like it. I like it very much. Breisacker's done a wonderful job here. But I move that we give it the deep six and move on to something that really needs brainstorming. Something important that needs a lot of sculling.
But what about my commercial?
Now, don't interrupt Fogarty when he's got something in the hopper. Bend the tree a little more, Fogarty, and maybe some of the branches will fall into place.
All right. Okay. I blue-skied this quite a bit, and I move that we find a summer replacement for Rin Tin Tin.
Agreed, agreed, agreed.
After Fogarty pulled that one, I could scarcely control myself. I could see them all staring at the white froth about my mouth. To ward off any suspicion, I whipped out a razor and shaved. As time went on, Miss Wilway and I fell hopelessly in love. But I dared not reveal my true identity. She might feel picky about being engaged to a werewolf. How was I to know if I could trust myself with her at night? Under a harvest moon, would I hold her hand or eat it? Then again, how could I take her home to father? I knew she was safe with mother. Whose bite hasn't been too effective ever since that night in the fog at Chappaqua when she mistakenly bit a bronze statue of Horace Greeley and lost all her teeth. But fate had a trick up her sleeve. One day at the office.
You rang for me, Mr. Brosacker.
Lucretia, my darling. Lucretia. We're alone at last. Oh, Lucretia. How long must we go on like this?
I could go on loving you forever, Al. But when am I going to meet your parents? I wish they'd have me for dinner sometime.
You don't know what you're saying, Lucretia. Hello? What's that? It's getting dark, and the sun is going down. Well, quickly, what time is it?
It's high noon.
High noon, great Scott. It must be an eclipse. I've got to get out of here.
Oh, stick around, Ralph.
It's so dark, I... Lucretia, now the truth is out. You see me as I really am. A werewolf.
Ralph, what a pleasant surprise.
Lucretia, you mean...
Yes, Ralph. When the sun goes down, I too am a werewolf.
I noticed your nylons were getting a little furry there.
your sweet hairy hand tight in mine. Clammy, clammy. But it's fine. I long for a darling damp face such as thine. As clammy, clammy, clammy as mine.
Say, Reisegger, how about this eclipse?
How about it, Fogarty?
Hey, that's the kind of animal we need to replace Rin Tin Tin. Just like those, you know, wolf suits you guys got on.
Not guys, Fogarty.
Lucretia. Yeah, what a riot you guys are in those costumes.
Isn't it wonderful how love always triumphs in the end, Lucretia? I've got you.
And I've got you.
And we've both got Fogarty!
Freeburg Show is produced in Hollywood by Pete Barnum and is written by Stan Freeburg and Pete Barnum with original songs by Stan Freeburg. Featuring the music of Billy May, Judd Conlon's Rhythm Airs, and the songs of Peggy Taylor with Dawes Butler, Peter Leeds, and June Foray. Bud Sewell speaking.
Oh, people, people, do you know what next Sunday is?
No! What is next Sunday?
Next Sunday, we have set aside 1 minute as a time of universal tap dancing. At the given moment, people around the world will put aside their differences and tap dance side by side for 1 minute. At the given time, stop. Get out of your car, step out of your houses, wherever you are, and let's tap dance with our fellow man. We'll have microphones set up around the world as each country joins in. That's a week from tonight as we set aside a time of universal tap dancing. Let this, then, be the first move toward international brotherhood. I hope you'll be with us next week. Meanwhile, this is Stan Freeburg saying thanks for being with us. God bless you, and good night.